in failure response is that in cargo, we have a degree of freedom, like I described earlier, that isn't present in crew. And that was the fact that I could tolerate or give up on mission success. In crew, your job is to really deliver the crew to the space station. So if you don't deliver the crew, you've really not accomplished what you're doing. Where in the cargo world, I can tolerate potential loss of cargo and station is maybe not as robust as it could be, but if I've done the right overall manifesting, I'm able to tolerate some number of failures on station and still keep station functioning and still do research. But crew has a very much unforgiving scenario. So it's the same thing when you have a failure with cargo. With a failure with cargo, the goal is to return and fly as fast as you can. When I say I can tolerate a failure, I can tolerate a failure of a single rocket because I have another provider that's in the wings that can provide cargo. So as long as that failure doesn't take out the entire launch system, that's acceptable to me. So I can take individual failures of individual flights. I cannot take a failure of the entire launch system and to be shut down for an extended period of time. And that's a really important concept. So this is very different than a satellite launch. It's very different than a crew launch. We can tolerate loss of a single rocket, and it's not the end of the ISS program, as you've seen and evidenced by what's just occurred. We've lost essentially three separate cargo vehicles, and station is still perfectly fine. We're still doing research, maybe not quite at the level we were before, but we're still able to move forward. But if we lose any one of those three components totally for an extended period of time, we're in big trouble. So the goal is we want to have the failure occur, learn from the failure, don't overreact to the failure, and get back to flight as soon as we can. And that's the secret of moving forward. That's the critical piece, that you're not trying to fix everything. Now, we've done that several times with the Progress vehicle. When it's failed in Russia, they've been able to come back and fly again fairly quickly in a matter of months. In the case of Orbital, we'll probably be able to come back and fly in about a year. But again, that's also a unique situation in the fact that Orbital has changed their launch vehicle to be able to come back and fly in a year. So instead of Orbital staying static and just continuing to fly on Antares and have to redesign Antares, bring the new engines in and test all that, they'll fly probably next spring, or they'll fly in about 18 months. They determined that their Cygnus was compatible with an Atlas V, and they found another launch vehicle, the Atlas V, to put their Cygnus on so they could take cargo to station. So they recognized from a corporate standpoint they wanted to continue to make revenue, so they wanted to deliver cargo to ISS. We needed them to fly as soon as they could go fly, so there was a natural synergy of we both had the same goals, maybe for slightly two different reasons, but it was basically to return to flight as soon as we thought it was safe to return to flight. So they will have had their failure roughly in October, and roughly 14 months later, they'll be back flying again with a Cygnus on top of an Atlas V in December. And that's really important to the station robustness and keeping things flying and moving forward. SpaceX, we'll see how long it takes for them to come back again. But again, I don't anticipate much more than maybe about roughly 8 months to a year before they're back to flying again. And then we're back in kind of a routine, robust situation, and we're moving forward.